is go right into the training. What I'm going to talk about on this training, what the job success score is, why Upwork uses this tool and lists it on your profile, what you need to know before you start a job regarding feedback and the job success score, because yes, it's something you should think about before you even accept an offer or bid on the job. And thank you, Sophie, for letting me know that you can see the slide as well. And then how to avoid common mistakes that will ultimately cost you a job success score. Now, that's based on my experience having reviewed hundreds of different proposals on Upwork. And then I'm also going to talk about this situation. This is a question that comes up a lot. Hey, I got bad feedback on my profile. Now my job success score is pretty low. What the heck do I do about that? Am I done on Upwork or is there any way to fix this? So there are several things I'm also not going to cover. This is a really specific training to the job success score aspects of your profile. I can do lots of trainings and I have great courses and materials on other aspects, but I just want everyone to know that I'm not really going to delve into how to write proposals on Upwork that land you the job, how to create work samples to help promote your ability and your expertise, how to charge clients or set rates. I know that's a really popular topic, but we just don't have the time to go into that today. How to find the right clients on Upwork. I'm going to talk a little bit about this in the context of a job success score and maintaining a really high job success score, but I'm not going to go into detail on that. If you and I have not met before and you're new to this group, I just want you to know a couple of things about why I'm covering this particular topic. I started out my freelance career back when it was Elance in 2012. I only merged my profile over to Upwork basically at the very last second after they kind of forced you to do it. So I'm actually pretty new to the Upwork platform. I think you could move it over 6 or 8 months before I did. And I kind of wanted to see how they were going to make that merge work. So I have been on Upwork since the fall of 2015, about November of 2015. But I've seen both sides of the table as it relates to hiring people on Upwork. I've not only gotten hundreds of jobs and leads from Upwork directly, but I have worked as a liaison between Elance and Upwork and their enterprise clients. I worked for TrueCar as a liaison. I worked for Microsoft as a liaison. So I've also seen the other side of Upwork quite a bit. And I've also hired quite a few of my own team members directly from Upwork. And I've looked at hundreds of job applications on Upwork and have done a lot of, you know, this kind of really feeds into my area of expertise about writing good proposals. There are proposals that not only land me the job, but also what I have seen other people do wrong. And a lot of people are doing the same things wrong over and over. And then they're saying, well, why am I not landing any gigs? So I always tell new freelancers that if you are going into Upwork to make a quick buck and thinking this is going to be a great way to make easy money, you are not using the platform as intended or the way that it would be most effective for you. Because much like anything where you're selling something, like say you're selling something on eBay, the feedback that you get from the other person in that transaction is really, really important. It could stop your entire use of that platform. Like imagine a person who just continuously scams people on eBay. Eventually eBay is going to shut their account down. So if you're on Upwork to make a quick buck and you land a project and get paid, but you do a really crappy job, that's going to be reflected in your job success score and other people are going to be hesitant about hiring you or working with you in the future. So your feedback is actually the most important thing that you're gathering on Upwork, because we're using that to land future jobs with the client who's leaving you the feedback and helping you get a higher job success score, but it also enables you to be hired by many other people. I think my feedback helps me land gigs all the time. People look at my profile and see feedback from past clients and they'll hire me directly or hire me with maybe 1 5-minute phone conversation just because of what other people have said. So it's the most important thing that we're collecting here on Upwork. It's really not about the money. And if you're here only for landing freelance gigs and making money, you're not going to last long on this platform, and this will dry up as a lead source for you. And you're not even using Upwork in the most effective way. Everybody today knows just how powerful social proof is. When is the last time you went to a restaurant that hadn't been highly vetted by multiple other people on Yelp? When's the last time that you bought a product that didn't come recommended from a friend or a family member or something like that, right? Feedback is a tool we are using all the time, whether it's Google reviews or Facebook feedback or anything like that. We're always looking at social proof. And anyone who runs a business today knows just how much that feedback can help or hurt a business. And what you are running as a freelancer is a business. So this social proof from your clients really matters. Many people who are starting out their online journey assume, well, if I just tell someone how amazing I am, what a great VA or project manager or graphic designer, that will be enough. Build it and they will come, so to speak. The internet is saturated and we see advertising all the time. So no longer is anyone going to trust you just because you say you are so great. You have to have something to back it up. Now, your work samples can help back up how great you are, the clients you've landed in the past, the fact that you're fully booked, all those things help to show how great you are. But the easiest and the most powerful is really amazing feedback from your clients directly. And you can do that on Upwork. Another reason that your feedback matters so much is because it shows that you're worth what you're quoting to the client. If you're charging a client $500, $1,000, charging hundreds of dollars per hour, but then you have horrible feedback where other people have had to cancel jobs with you and have had a bad experience, that client is not going to throw a lot of money your way. And unfortunately, there are scam artists out there like this on Upwork and off who think they can just make a quick amount of money and then disappear and never use the platform again. Odds are you're going to encounter clients who have been burned like this. So you need to be aware of that and how it can actually help you as you're growing your freelance business. A lot of my clients have come to me and said, listen, I hired somebody else. They were dirt cheap and the product was terrible. So people are hesitant because of that. They're concerned about being scammed. They're spending their hard-earned money or their business's hard-earned marketing dollars, and they want to know that it's going to somebody who's high quality. So you can live up to the money that you are quoting to the client by having great feedback. Also, when you have good feedback and a high job success score, you're going to show up as a recommended freelancer on the part of Upwork. So Upwork is going to say, oh, hey, here's this person who has a really high job success score who is well worth putting at the top of the list of bids. We're going to specifically send an email to the client that says, Laura P is a great candidate for your job, blah, blah, blah. So they're going to get a personalized email when you're one of those people that they have recognized. And that is not just about your job success score. A lot of people have that impression that, well, I'm going to have 100% job success score. I'm not going to be a featured proposal. I'm not going to get that special email. That is not completely true. But it definitely will help you to have a great job success score. The better and more consistent your score is, the easier it will be for doors to fly open for you. And then clients really don't understand what job success score is. Heck, even as freelancers, we're like, well, what actually goes into that? Upwork will not tell anyone what that algorithm is because they don't want people gaming the system. Clients don't really understand what a job success score is, but let's say you have a 50% job success score. To a client, that looks like you're only 50% effective or 50%, you know, capable of finishing the job. That doesn't telegraph anything good to the client. So even though they don't understand all the metrics that go in there, maybe it's just that you had to cancel a number of jobs because you had a personal issue that came up. But a client doesn't really understand that. A client just sees a number, a percentage on your profile. So because they don't understand it, you need to take all your feedback really seriously and adjust accordingly when you are bringing on new clients. So what actually is job success score? What does this term even mean, right? This is shown as a percentage on your profile, and it's based on a lot of different factors, including the public feedback your client leaves for you, the private feedback that they're leaving directly with Upwork, and repeat business that you land. It also includes factors like how often you're canceling jobs with clients, how many jobs you have pending open that haven't had activity for a long period of time, etc. There's a lot of different factors that go into it. And later in the training, I'm going to talk about four ways to make sure that you always have a really good job success score. So we'll talk a little bit about that, but there's no like, you know, 100 point checklist of do all these things and you will have a perfect job success score. You know, mine has fluctuated between 92 and 99% for the entire time I've been on Upwork, and I still haven't exactly figured out what factors they're using. And sometimes I'll see it jump or decrease and I won't even know why, right? So we're going to take our best shot at keeping a high job success score. Some people get really hung up on this idea of, well, I want to be 96% or higher, and they put all of their energy into figuring out, you know, what's this exact calculation? And really, you're just driving yourself crazy. Most clients really don't care whether you're 96% or 98% with the job success score. They just want to know that you're, you know, generally above 90% and pretty capable of finishing a job completely. So don't get hung up on, oh, I've been stuck at 93 forever and I want to get to 95. Just keep doing a good job with your clients and inevitably you will see that increase. For the longest time, I was at 94 and I got so frustrated. I'm like, well, my clients are leaving me great feedback. What the heck is this about? Why is this happening? And the minute that I stopped caring about my job success score and just started focusing on doing right by my clients and delivering on deadline and all those great things, my job success score increased to 99% and has stayed there. So don't get hung up on it unless you have a really low job success score. Then that is a pretty serious problem to be aware of. Now, your job success score, yes, it matters in the grand scheme of things. In general, clients want to see a good job success score, but doing a consistent good job with your clients is more important than anything. And consistency is where 95% of freelancers fall off. They love the adrenaline rush of getting the gig, but they can't follow through, or they take on too many jobs at once and they can't meet deadlines or turn in sloppy work. So being consistent and doing a great job for your clients, that's always going to matter regardless of all these other factors, right? And that will get telegraphed to Upwork in the public and private feedback. So a couple more things about job success score that I've noticed and that I've learned from talking to people who work at Upwork. First of all, long-term repeat business helps you significantly, okay? The more clients that you have that are giving you business every single week or month, the easier it will be to boost your job success score. Now, that's also beneficial because of the fee that Upwork takes out of what you're earning every time. So the more money you earn with a client, the less percentage of that that you're paying to Upwork. It also just helps you establish a really good reputation on Upwork because people see that you're consistent, that you're able to deliver work on the regular to a client. So I've actually had a client on Upwork for a long enough time that I could move him off the platform. But honestly, it's better for me to just leave the long-term business on Upwork and allow that to keep showing up that I've had this open contract for years. So that's worth considering as well. And a lot of people get concerned by saying, well, my clients never leave me feedback. They just never follow through on it. Now, here is a place where Upwork could do better. They assume that when a client doesn't leave you feedback, that the client is simply following the golden rule of if you have nothing nice to say, don't say anything at all. Most clients are not filling out the feedback because they're busy, because they forget about it, or because they have no idea just how important it is to you. So that seems really unfair to freelancers, but Upwork only takes in excessive lack of feedback as a way for you to lose percentage points on your job success score. So if you've had 10 jobs and all 10 of those people left you no feedback, Upwork is interpreting that as all 10 clients being uncomfortable with leaving you feedback and not wanting to do damage to you. But the fact that a client chooses not to use feedback, it doesn't always mean that, right? But that's why we're going to prompt our clients to leave us feedback. And I'm going to cover that a little bit more later in the training. So excessive lack of feedback is what counts, not one or two clients who don't leave you feedback. I mean, I have clients I've worked with for months and months, and they'll throw me something every single month to do, and then they never leave me feedback on that job. You know, it doesn't even matter how many times I prompt them. That's just how some clients are. So hopefully that's something in the future that Upwork will look into. Some clients are choosing to follow the golden rule. Others are just too busy and they don't even want to take 5 seconds to leave you feedback. That shouldn't hurt you, right? I want to talk a little bit about how the job success score, that percentage in the corner of the profile, has impacted me directly. It has definitely made it easier to connect with clients because my proposals tend to get pushed to the top because I have a good job success score, because that good job success score has allowed me to become a member of the Upwork pro community and because I'm classified as a top rated freelancer because of the feedback that I get. So yes, anything good that helps you stand out to a client is a great thing. So a good job success score can help you significantly. And that's always going to benefit you as you grow your business. One thing I've also learned too that I've mentioned a little bit already is it's important to ask the client for feedback. They may assume that it's really not that important to you. If you tell them, hey, by the way, I'm going to leave great feedback for you. If you could leave me positive feedback because we had a great experience working together, it really helps me land future business. Like you need to tell the client exactly why they need to leave you feedback, because you're essentially asking them for 2 more minutes of their time. Doesn't seem like a huge commitment, but it is a big deal in the busy world we live in. And otherwise, they don't know that leaving no feedback is kind of detrimental to your job success score. So that's why we want to tell them directly, please leave me feedback. It's super important for me as I build my business and really helps me land other clients. When you ask like that, a client's going to spend the 2 minutes to leave you the feedback. And I do that with every client I have. Will all of them follow through? No. But it's really a good idea to let them know why they're doing it, that there's actually a purpose, because otherwise they're just going to ignore it. They're going to say, yay, I'm happy. I've received my finished product. I'm going to move on with my life. No, we got to ask them for the feedback. Do it before the job wraps up if you can, and let them know. And especially if it's a big job, right? I had a $10,000 job on Upwork last year, and the client was super busy and actually wrapping up the project because we finished earlier than anticipated and she was going to go on a 3-month vacation. So you better believe I pinged her on Slack like 5 times. Can you please leave feedback? It will really help me land other jobs like this. And sure enough, she went in and left amazing feedback. Great, you know, paragraph testimonial and 5-star feedback that, that shows to Upwork, yes, this $10,000 job was something I did a good job on. And I just didn't want that to fall short because the client didn't know that it was important. Now, another thing to keep in mind, and I'm a big personal responsibility type of gal here. So I'm always going to encourage you to take personal responsibility where you can for certain aspects of your business. Sometimes I have gotten poor feedback. Now I have more than 300 feedback scores combined from my Elance and Upwork profile. There are definitely some less than ideal pieces of feedback on there. But when that has happened, I have looked back on the situation and said, what did I do to earn that? Did I play a role in that situation? Whether it was not meeting the client's expectations, whether it was not screening the client properly and working with someone I never should have worked with to begin with, or whatever the situation was, not canceling the job sooner when this client became a nightmare. Use every situation as a learning experience. I see a lot of people who have bad feedback scores, particularly if it's like 50 or 60%. They're like, well, it's just not fair. My clients just aren't leaving me feedback. Trust me, they are. If your feedback score is that low, they are leaving you private feedback with Upwork. They may be nice on the public end of things, but on the private end, the client is tearing you a new one, okay? And you're not seeing it, but Upwork is, and they're using that for your feedback. So you need to really be honest about, hey, did I screw up here? And you can be proactive about this. Like if you're in the middle of a job and you know you're not going to meet the deadline, or you don't have enough information or instructions to finish, figure out what you can do to fix it. There have been clients where I delivered late. That has happened a couple of times. And once I knew I was going to deliver late. And I'm like, you know what? I told this client Wednesday, I'm not going to be ready by Wednesday. I'm going to reach out in the Upwork workroom and say, hey, here's the deal. I can't deliver on Wednesday. Can get it to you on Friday. I'd be happy to either apply a 10% discount to the rate that I quoted you or throw in blah, 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 some extra, you know, some, if it's a blog, I'd throw in some social media quips they could share on Twitter or Facebook with the blog, or free photos, you know, licensed stock photos. So I preempted the situation from being bad feedback because I said, hey, I told you this, I wasn't able to live up to it. Here is my concession by recognizing in advance that I'm not going to meet your expectations. And even in those situations, you can have good feedback. I have a client that I fired last fall, and I was really worried about that. It had been so long since I'd had negative feedback on my profile. And I'm like, here it comes. He's going to leave negative feedback. Instead, I offered to do a 5-minute phone call about why I was wrapping up the project and gave him plenty of notice so he could find another freelancer. And lo and behold, he left me 5-star feedback. So these little gestures that you do before the fact, like not turning the work in a week late and then expecting the client to leave you 5-star feedback, but being proactive really helps. Same thing if you get sick, like people get sick. Parents have emergencies with their kids. Stuff happens in life. Tell your client about it. You can avoid a bad feedback situation by being proactive and telling the client as soon as possible. And it's hard to do. It's scary, but you'll find that 9 times out of 10, the client is understanding, and sometimes they don't even care at all. They're like, oh, whatever. That's fine if you deliver Wednesday or Friday instead of Wednesday. All right. So there are a few ways that clients leave feedback on Upwork that you need to understand as a freelancer. The first and the one that people know the most about is the public. This is literally what shows up on your profile, the comments that the client leaves, the star rating. So it's between 1 and 5 stars that they'll leave you. And it's the one that everybody else can see too. So not only are you capable of seeing it on your profile, but it is what other people are seeing as well. So really, obvious quite there. Okay. But also, clients leave private feedback. At the end of the contract, they are prompted to leave private feedback specifically for Upwork. So in a way, this is like the client's chance to say, I left them a 4 out of 5 rating, but really this project was a nightmare and I wouldn't work with this person again. So if you're only pushing the client to leave you positive public feedback, they can still leave you terrible private feedback. And it doesn't help to have these jumbled, because then Upwork sees that basically you got an artificial public feedback. It's not helping your job success score. And that's why doing a good job with your clients and being proactive when there's a problem so that you can meet expectations or make a concession can ensure that you're getting positive feedback on both ends. Now, sometimes the client won't fill out the private feedback. So it's not the end of the world, but we want to encourage them to leave you positive feedback in both venues. If you only have good public feedback, guess what? Upwork still knows. Upwork knows that you have not done the great job that you think you've done. They are using that information behind the scenes. And the worst part, you're not even seeing it. So you don't know what that client has really said about you. This is one reason that I like to ask for feedback, especially if it's a big job. Ask for feedback midway through the job. Say, hey, I just want to make sure that I'm meeting or exceeding your expectations. It's really important for me that I'm striving for 5-star feedback from you and a great experience that you're having working with me. So I just want to know, is there anything different I can do? Because sometimes clients aren't the best at communicating, but if you ask them directly, hey, am I meeting the goals and expectations for this project? And if not, how can we fix it? How can a client leave you bad feedback if you at least reached out and asked about that in advance? So another way to be really proactive. This question comes up a lot. What exactly is a good job success score? How do I know if I have a good job success score? And this ranges. I've got information from Upwork. I've got information from what I think is a good job success score when I'm hiring people on the platform. And then there's just generally accepted advice. So not an easy answer here, right? I'm not gonna make it cut and dry. I would say that above 85% is usually considered good, because 85% is pretty solid. It means you've had some clients who may not have been happy, but if I'm a hiring manager, I may write that off and say, yeah, well, some clients are really difficult to deal with and basically impossible to please. So it's believable that a handful of times that the client hasn't been happy. May not even be the freelancer's fault. Most clients are looking at 90% and above. And the reason is this: if I'm hiring freelancers on Upwork and I see, you know, 50 proposals and 20 of them are from freelancers who have a job success score of 90% and above, why would I even look at the other ones? If I have ample people to choose from at 90% and above, I'm very unlikely to look at somebody who has a 70% approval rating. So you're going to have to do a lot more to stand out if you're in that lower category. And it also depends on the competition. If you're doing something that there's not a lot of competition, you can get away with a lower job success score. But if you're competing against really highly ranked professional freelancers who are at 90% and above, you're going to notice a difference in the gigs that you land. And then Upwork's guidance says that you're going to have a hard time if you're below 75. And then I would say if you're below 60, I'm going to say it's going to be really hard for you to land jobs, because 50%, that's like 50, it's like a coin toss. Are you going to do the job or not? Are you capable of finishing the job? Are you as good as you say you are? So that this is sort of general guidelines. Do you want to strive for 85% and above? Of course. Is it the end of the world if you're at 75 right now? No, it's not the end of the world, but we're definitely going to want to work on your marketing strategy to land some more gigs where you can get better feedback and start to build that job success score back up again. So we don't want you to stay stuck at 75 forever. Now, your job success score does have one sort of what I would consider a friendly aspect of it. It's taken from the highest score of several different averages. So they look at the last 6 months, what's your average score, the last 12, and then the last 24. And then they'll take the highest one. So at least they do that kindness to you where, you know, let's say you had a crappy client 2 years ago and you really wish you could just bury that one star feedback forever. That guy was a jerk, whatever. It's not going to be that feedback score that Upwork is pulling from. And even if you've had some screw ups in, you know, the last 6 months, because you had an issue and you had to stop working and cancel jobs, maybe your 12 month or 24 month score is higher and Upwork will rely on that. So that's another reason why you can suddenly see these dramatic changes in your profile. Like a couple months ago, I noticed that mine went from 93 to 99. And I'm like, what? Like, I literally haven't even finished any jobs with clients. How am I up to 99? Now, and I haven't even been very active on Upwork. It's because that moving average changed and they gave me the highest one of the last of whatever of these they pulled from. So no easy answer here either. We're going to focus on good short and long-term feedback. Good feedback is never going to hurt you. Bad feedback is not the end of the world, but try to shoot for generally good feedback from your clients. That will help you a lot. And Upwork, like I said, they're never going to reveal exactly the metrics they're pulling from, who said what, because they don't want people trying to game the system. And unfortunately, people do that and they kind of ruin it for everybody. And that is really unfortunate. But Upwork is trying to avoid that. And that's why they're not going to tell you every little detail that goes into your job success score. So I hear a lot of people say, well, my job success score is basically zero because no one's ever left me feedback on Upwork, or I'm bidding on my first job. This is a job I recently posted on Upwork, and these are the top three candidates that Upwork presented to me. Now look at how different they are. I have the choice here of someone who's earned around $1,000 and has 100% job success. Pretty good, but they're still new to Upwork, right? That could be a fluke that they just did one job well. I've got a second freelancer here who's only earned $100 and that client never left them feedback or the job is still open. And then I have a third person who has much more Upwork experience, but their job success score is lower. Now, these were the quote unquote top three candidates that I was presented. And there's a lot of variation here. Now, I may choose to go with the person who has an 88% job success score because one, they've earned a lot of money on Upwork. They clearly are capable of finishing and completing jobs. They've been doing this for a little while. And look, that one and the top one have been recommended to me because the freelancer worked on two jobs similar to the one I posted. So see, it is not just about your job success score. And I know that when I hire for talent and not necessarily experience. Experience helps, but sometimes it's better to work with somebody new who's really hungry for it and who is capable of learning, doesn't have their own entrenched ideas of how things should be. So yes, I'm going to look at that second proposal, even though that person's only earned $100 on Upwork, because maybe their work samples are amazing and maybe I want to work with them. You know, maybe they're not going to be as busy as the person who's earned $20,000 on Upwork. That person may have multiple clients, might be more likely to make mistakes. So it's not just about your job success score or even lack of experience. The algorithms that Upwork uses to present candidates are random. What's always going to increase your chances are great work samples and a great pitch and overall good feedback. That's really going to help. So don't get hung up necessarily. Another thing to keep in mind is the default 90% job success score showing. When someone posts a gig on Upwork, Upwork is going to automatically fill in the box that the client wants somebody who has a 90% job success score or above. Most clients don't even see that. I didn't even see it when I posted my most recent job. So don't stress about that. Most clients don't know it's there. unless they specifically put in their job proposal, hey, I'm only looking for freelancers who have a job success score of 90% or above. Like they put that in the actual text of the request for proposals. I would not stress out about it. Okay. Cause most clients don't even realize that they've selected that. And as you can see, that was auto selected on the bid I just showed you. And look, there's somebody here who has an 88% job success and there's somebody here who has no feedback yet. So not the end of the world. You're not going to get cut off completely if you don't meet that. Now, if the client is just adamant, oh, I have to have somebody who's 90% job success score and above, then you may be cut out of the job. But I find that that's the exception and not necessarily the rule. So Upwork likes to recommend those with a 90% success score and above, typically because that's seen as pretty reliable, right? Hiring a stranger on the internet is a scary thing, even for your clients who have used Upwork before or who have worked with freelancers before. So by recommending somebody who has a 90% job success score and above, they're giving the client a reasonable chance that the job is going to get completed. They're presenting a good pool of candidates to the client. So that's why they use that particular metric. But again, the client most of the time doesn't even know it's there. You know, sometimes they are super picky and they're like, we will only accept a US freelancer who is in the Pacific time zone and has 90% or above. They're just picky clients. And guess what? Those people are everywhere. So that may not be the job for you. Now, even if that's the case, and let's say you're at 89% or 85%, you can still get around this by having great samples and a good pitch. As a client, when I hire, I am not looking just at the job success score. I am considering people who are brand new, who are interested and hungry for the work and willing to learn and capable of growing with me or with me and the client. If I see a good pitch and great work samples, I'm going to overlook that 85%. Depends on what the feedback says, right? If I go look at their profile and somebody left a comment like, I never heard from this freelancer after they submitted the first draft and it was a huge nightmare, well, then I'm probably not going to hire them. But if they have an 85% job success score, just because no client has left them feedback or they only have a couple of feedback scores or they're not that active on Upwork, I'm not going to use that to rule them out because again, there's so many factors that are going into this idea of your job success score. So when you're not in the top performers and have a really low job success score, other proposals are going to be listed first. So in the example that I showed you a couple of slides back, there were freelancers who, were lower down in the list and, you know, they're like 40% or, and you'll see this a lot if clients are allowing proposals from offshore candidates. So not just North America or Europe, but other locations, you will get proposals. Like I have literally gotten proposals from people who have like a 50% job success score. And I didn't even, you know, read their pitch. It's like, nope, you're doing something wrong if it's at 50%. You know, I can understand 80, 85, 80, you know, even 75 if you had a little, you know, issue and you explain it and you have amazing work samples and a great pitch. But 50%, no, way too much of a risk. People just aren't going to take it. Would you buy from the eBay seller that has, you know, 50% negative reviews or, you know, neutral and negative and then 50% good? Probably not. Think twice. Find another seller. They may be less confident hiring you because those very low job success scores, and I'm talking about 60% and below, are at the bottom of the list. They may never even get to your proposal, and you're definitely not getting that sort of special email that says, so-and-so is a great candidate for this job. In this situation, it's actually better to be a complete newbie that has no feedback than someone who's done three jobs where two of them involved really bad feedback. Because there's metrics of risk involved here. When I'm hiring a freelancer on Upwork, or even when I'm looking at a client's feedback, right? Because feedback goes two ways on Upwork, and you should be looking at your client's feedback that other freelancers have left. It's better to say, well, this person's really new, or they've only worked one job on Upwork, but they seem really passionate about this topic. They seem like they could really do a good job for me. I'm gonna take a chance on them. I'm taking much more of a chance if I'm hiring the guy who's had three jobs and two of them were poor feedback and one was no feedback, because that means he's not got a great batting average, right? Something went wrong here. And although it's possible that the clients could have been the problem, as a freelancer, again, personal responsibility, don't take on crappy clients, even on Upwork, especially on Upwork because of the feedback. factor. So clients are willing to take more of a risk on a total newbie. So that's good news for those of you who have not yet landed your first job on Upwork, because it's you're still going to be more likely to be hired than the people who show up with bad feedback. And it would blow your mind how many people bid on Upwork jobs when they have terrible feedback. Oh, and they most of those same people also have terrible proposals. I have read them. They spell things wrong. The proposals make no sense. They go on for 17 paragraphs, none of which are good. So you've always got an edge over those people, and there are more of them than you think, you know? So don't give up. We all start somewhere on Upwork or with any marketing strategy, and you can't get better and better or get closer to the top until you have more and more experience. So just keep building that experience and knock it out of the park when you do land a client, because then you're going to zoom past not just those people with bad feedback. You're going to land yourself among the top performers on Upwork and get really be taken seriously over the long haul. Another question I hear a lot from people is, oh my gosh, I got hired and then the client disappeared. What the heck? Now I'm going to get bad feedback because I'm going to have to cancel this job, or Upwork's going to see that this job is inactive and lower my job success score. This actually begins with the work you do as a freelancer selecting or approving a client. When you get started with someone on Upwork, you need to be crystal clear. And I like to do this by saying something like, oh, sure, are you ready to get started? I can block some time in my schedule this Thursday, include the date, for blank block of time. Is that a good time for me to get started? I could then deliver by Friday morning. That makes it really concrete, and that we're not interested in tire kickers or the person who's hiring someone on Upwork and then needs 5 more weeks to think about it or get you the instructions. And sometimes people do that. They're like, I need to outsource. I need to delegate. They hop on Upwork, they hire somebody, and then they forget about it, or they're not organized enough. And that only hurts you as the freelancer, right? Here you were thinking, here's my new gig. I'm going to do it well. I'm going to do it on time and get great feedback. And now the client has ghosted me. So be really firm with getting started. And that is another great marketing tactic that tells people you're in high demand too, by saying, I have time on my schedule on this day during this time. Does that work for you? Could you have all the instructions to me by 24 hours prior? That puts the ball in the client's court of, are you really serious about hiring me and starting this project? That makes sure that you are not facing a ghosting situation. And then if the client doesn't respond to you multiple times, we do want to cancel that job, because it's not going to help you to have an open job where there's no activity. Another thing to do to get the ball rolling, get escrow funded immediately. There is nothing like people spending money to get them highly motivated to give you the materials you need to do the job. So don't, you know, you can even tell them in the Upwork workroom before they hire you, like, don't start the contract until we're ready to go. Please give me such and such hours of notice so I can fit this into my calendar. And as soon as escrow is funded, I can begin the work or whatever. As soon as my hourly contract begins, I will get you on the calendar the very next week. It puts some firm boundaries and ground rules in place for the client. And it also says to them, like, hey, I don't want you dithering around for 3 weeks deciding whether you really want to do this project or not. Let's go forward immediately. I blocked time for you. Yes, yes, I got ghosted and it hurt my job success score and I didn't get escrow on it either. Yeah, sadly, it's one of those things where you learn it after the fact. Like, you're trying to do the right thing. You're all excited. Here comes this client. You're like, yes, I'm going to get a gig on Upwork. This is so cool. And then they ghost you. And you're like, well, wait a second. I put time in my schedule for you. And now there's no work for me to do. So I'm not working on stuff for other clients. And you're not really paying me because we don't really have activity going on right now. So give them a motivation to get started, like, right away. Or just say, hey, you know, hire me when you're ready to go. Because that's I need some lead time to get it into my calendar. I want to make sure I'm meeting your goals too. Always just push it back on the client. Like, they'll actually like that you're being that organized and thoughtful ahead of time by saying, like, hey, I want to get you on my calendar. I need you to do X, Y, and Z before we can get started. So this situation comes up a lot. So now let's flip briefly to the positive before I go into the biggest mistakes that end up hurting your job success score. All those metrics aside, I have found in my experience, and I have more than 400 jobs on Upwork and Elance together, there are 4 things you need for a winning job success score. In my opinion, 85% and above. Still, 80% is not the end of the world, right? But this is what I believe is most important. getting good clients to begin with. If I take on nightmare clients every time and then they leave me crappy feedback or ghost me or leave no feedback at all, I'm not helping my job success score, right? Those tend to be the clients who are a once and done project anyways. So I'm not even getting the benefit of repeat work on the Upwork platform. So getting good clients, like, you play an important role in this as a freelancer of selecting the right clients. This is a two-way street. Just because someone offers you a job or invites you to a job doesn't mean you need to accept it. We want to screen carefully because we want good clients for your sanity's sake, but also for that great job success score and feedback. Of course, repeat contracts and long-term relationships. Retainer queen here, all right? 98% of my clients are on retainers. It doesn't even matter if they're on Upwork or not. Long-term relationships allow you to plan your income. They make your life the easiest. You become an expert in the client's industry, in the way they want things. You work faster because of that. You build really meaningful networking relationships. I've had clients that I've worked with on smaller retainers that have referred me $25,000 and $30,000 retainers. So these repeat contracts and long-term relationships help you, especially on Upwork. Remember, I told you about that one client. Technically, we could move off the platform, but do I really care that, you know, I'm giving 5 or 10% of every job to Upwork on that gig? Not really, because it's showing that I have great repeat business and this client is paying me every 2 weeks to do something. So it doesn't hurt me, and not enough of a motivation to move it off the platform, right? Next thing is finishing the work in a timely fashion. Remember, most of the time you're the one setting the deadline, and this is in my mistakes section coming up, people who don't set the deadline the right way. When you finish the work in the time period that you set yourself, you're going to have a great job success score. I always tell people to give yourself a buffer of a day. What if something happens? What if, you know, you work from the library and your car breaks down and you can't get to the library, or your internet is crap today and you can't get things uploaded, or your kid is sick and you literally can't work? By giving yourself a day of a buffer, you will make the client thrilled if everything goes according to plan and you deliver early. And worst case scenario, you're one day behind and you can catch up. So don't cut yourself too short with the deadlines. Most of the time, they're kind of arbitrary. Like, the client doesn't actually know how long it's going to take you to do the particular project, but you need to be the one who is responsible for setting good deadlines. And then finally, we want that positive feedback both privately and publicly. So when we have good clients and they love working with us and we're doing a great job, this is like a no-brainer. You don't even really have to ask, right? They're always leaving you great feedback. Okay, so those are the four things that I would focus on wherever possible. Now, when you're new on Upwork, it's going to be a little bit harder to get those repeat contracts, but you can use your one-off projects or those smaller projects to build really good feedback to land those repeat contracts. So I had zero clients on retainer when I first started, and it took me a while to see how retainers work and how to close clients with retainers. But all those little one-off jobs of a few $100 here and a couple hundred over there helped me earn retainers because it was all positive feedback. And now I'm going to talk about the most common mistakes that I see people making on Upwork that is killing your job success score. Okay. Number one, screwing up the very first job. So exciting to land that first gig or those first five gigs on Upwork. You're blowing through the work to get paid because finally, oh my God, you've invested all this time on bidding on Upwork and making work samples, and now you're finally getting paid. So you blow through it quickly and you didn't really read the directions and the client's not that thrilled, or you deliver late. Screwing up the very first job is so detrimental to you. It's such a bad decision. And that can even mean like taking on a bad client. So taking on a client where other freelancers have left poor feedback for that client. Now we've made a bad decision because other people tried to warn us. They tried to say, this client is terrible, don't work with them. And we did it anyways, because dang it, we were so excited to get that first Upwork job or the first Upwork job in a while. Don't take them on. These bad clients are never worth it, okay? A few bad feedback scores can stop you forever in the beginning. Now, think about it this way. I have hundreds of feedback scores. Many freelancers have dozens of feedback comments. A handful of bad feedback, private or public, isn't going to kill somebody who has hundreds, because we're talking about averages here. Remember, Upwork is taking averages of the past 2 years, year, and 6 months. However, if you've done five jobs on Upwork and three of them have terrible feedback, you're going to have a really hard time recovering from that. I liken this to what I used to tell my brother when he entered high school. And of course, he totally ignored my advice. I said, trust me, start with all A's. It's way easier to maintain an all A average that drops a little bit in your senior year because you've got senioritis than it is trying to play catch up in your senior year when it's too late and all the averaging of your grades has already hurt you. Same thing applies to Upwork. When you are just starting out, you need to deliver a five-star experience to every client because this feedback is everything. It could open the doors to all your future work. The first couple of feedback scores are well worth the time and energy to blow the client's socks off, okay? If you're brand new to Upwork, you cannot afford to slack off. You cannot afford to make mistakes here because screwing up these very first couple of jobs or the very first job, you now have an obstacle to overcome every single time you bid. Much easier to start strong and stay there. Another Upwork mistake, taking on the wrong clients. Upwork has a two-way feedback system for a reason. If another freelancer, and especially if more than one freelancer has told you in the feedback, you can go look at the client's profile and see what other people have had to say. If you are seeing that from multiple freelancers, run, do not walk away from that client. If a person seems difficult to work with from day one, they're demanding of your time, they don't show up for your phone call and call you 30 minutes later, they're just in general rude, no, we don't want to work with them because that's just who their personality is. And you know, there's some people that in their mind, 3 stars is 5 stars, right? That's the best they will ever give because they are picky people. If we can avoid working with those people to the best of our ability, that's going to increase your chance of a good job success score. And also, I always say we're only in control of 2 things in the freelance world, our time and our energy. Do not let a vampire, a client vampire, suck both of those away. Don't, okay? Not worth it. Not worth the money. Definitely not worth the risk to your feedback score. Now, don't accept the first offer that's thrown your way if past freelancer feedback indicates they're hard to work with. They may be thinking that you're like a dummy, like you're new to Upwork and you've only got 80% feedback. So you really need the gig. So they can get away with treating you like crap and being difficult to work with because you won't want to harm your feedback score. Trust me, if it's happened already, that cycle will repeat. So always look at the client's feedback profile. And again, cut them the same slack that they're hopefully cutting you. If they've done 10 jobs and one person had a mediocre experience, probably not an indication that this person is a jerk. However, if I ever see more than one, and especially if those 2 distinct freelancers have said the same thing, like, I never heard from this client again, or he filed an Upwork dispute against me. Oh, game over. You know, we're not going to go down that road. And anyone who says a comment like this should always be avoided. Oh, I've fired the last 5 freelancers I worked with. And I've learned this one from personal experience because I thought, well, maybe as number 6, I'll be different. Nope, I ended up having to fire them because they were a disaster. And if they fired multiple other people, it indicates a problem with them, not with the freelancer. So always look for clues with your clients. You do not have to work with anybody, Upwork, non-Upwork. You're not required to work with anybody. So keep that in mind. Another mistake that can kill your job success score is taking on too many jobs or jobs outside your skill set level. Let's say I saw this job that was like kind of a fit for me, like it was copywriting, but then they also wanted me to do like Google AdWords, which I know nothing about. I am setting myself up for failure by taking on that job and not just being honest with the client saying, yeah, this really isn't in my wheelhouse. You can split this up and I can do the copywriting and someone else can do the AdWords, or maybe you just need to look for that, you know, dream freelancer who does both. If you take on too many jobs and overload yourself, you're probably going to do low quality work. You're going to be rushed to a deadline. You're going to feel stressed out. You know, challenge yourself, but don't promise something you can't do. Don't tell 5 clients you can all do their work tomorrow and then you crash and burn tomorrow and you're only able to do 1 person's and then the other 4 people are pissed off. It's just not worth it. I see some freelancers do this, like they're just so happy. Oh, I finally turned the tide on Upwork. Now I'm making tons of money and getting gigs. Well, not really, because if these clients all come to you at the same time and you give them unreasonable expectations, then they're just gonna, these jobs are gonna crash and burn. You're gonna get poor feedback. And it's not worth taking on 10 jobs in a week if you end up doing a poor job on all of them. It's better to take on one or two jobs that you can do really well and get amazing feedback on rather than those 10. Because what's Upwork gonna see when they're averaging your feedback? Wow, this person had an amazing opportunity to work on 10 gigs and didn't do a great job with any of them. So lower job success score. Focus on quality over quantity. I see this one a lot too, especially with new freelancers, have no idea how long it's going to take them. So they say, oh, I can totally do this in 48 hours. And then they realize that editing a 30,000 word manuscript is definitely going to take more than the next two business days. You are in charge of setting the delivery. Occasionally you'll see clients on Upwork that say, I'd really love it if this could be done this week. Tell them if that's unreasonable, okay? Like, I have a client who does that to me, and like sometimes they're reasonable. Sometimes she's like, I need 8 emails. Can you do that this week? And it's like, no, I can't. I really can't fit that in. When I can deliver it is blah, blah, blah time next week. Most clients are understanding, not worth overestimating your ability. And as I said before, honestly, I think one of the reasons that I've been successful as a freelancer and a lot of the other successful freelancers I know, it's not even that we're the most talented people in the world. Like, I'm an okay writer. I am not a Pulitzer Prize winning writer. What has made me and others stand out is consistency, the ability to follow through, right? This is why I have clients who've been with me on retainer for years, because I follow through every single time. So don't overestimate your delivery ability. Not worth it. Most clients aren't giving you time-sensitive information, but they'll still be ticked off if you said you'd have it to them in a couple days and then you can't get it to them, because they were probably basing everything on their end off of that. Like, let's imagine that, you know, you're a virtual assistant and your client gave you a job to pull together contact information from a database, and they wanted it by Friday because they're going to hit the ground Monday making cold calls to this list of contacts you came up with. If you don't get it to them on Friday, their entire schedule for the beginning of that next week is screwed up. So you need to communicate if problems arise, if you underestimated how much of your work would be involved here. The clients, honestly, most of the time just want to know what's going on. Most of the time, they will be totally reasonable. If you say, you know what, I really underestimated how much of this I was going to be able to do in a day. Here's what I can do instead, and then give them an update. Be honest about your availability as well as your ability to do the job. Now, like I said before, challenge yourself, like take on things. You know, I had a client, one of my retainer clients that came to me from a referral a couple months ago. I only write sales copy for them. That's usually not completely in my wheelhouse. I usually do SEO content, but I was really upfront with them about it and said, hey, you know, I write all my sales copy for one of my businesses. It converts pretty well. I think I can do it, but I just want you to know, like, I'm not certified in this or anything. There's going to be a bit of a learning curve. And we have grown together working on those projects just because I was honest about it. I did not say, you know, I'm Bob Bly or I'm the greatest copywriter who's ever existed. No, just be honest about your availability as well as your ability to do it. And as I mentioned above, even if you screw up on a project that wasn't like urgent, the client is definitely going to be upset. They're really going to be upset if you do screw up on a project that is time sensitive. Like, if you're a graphic designer creating a logo and they were going to take that logo to the CEO tomorrow and they don't have it today, now they look like an idiot in front of their boss. So